Those of you that have listened to some of my messages, you will know what I teach about the vengeance of God. But the Lord has just shown me even more about the vengeance of God and the outpouring of the anger of God on the earth. And we're going to talk about that. It's an exciting topic. Amen. It makes me really happy. You know, it's something that I welcome. Glory to God. We want the vengeance of God. We want the anger of God. We want the wrath of God. That's what we want. You know, because that is what sets us free. Well, now, you might say, but Bertie, you know, you've got the wrong word there. You know, you should use love. You should use peace. You should use forgive. You should use those kind of things. Now, you know, like I said, to give you a brief introduction to what I want to say is, you remember what I talked about, the slave, you know, like Audrey said, the slave, and then the son. I mean, the slave wants the anger of his father. You know, if you are a slave and somebody has kidnapped you and taken you and put you in a place where you are abused, where you are a slave, you welcome the anger of your father. Yep. Isn't it? You want the anger of your father. Because what the anger of the father will do is it will set you free. Amen. From the sins that is being committed towards you. Amen. Amen. What we said this morning is that it's a sin that the people of God are dying. It's a sin that the people of God don't have peace and joy and comfort and rest and those kind of things. That is a sin. Yes. So a sin defined from the Father's perspective, and for those of you that haven't been here, let me just quickly just use this analogy again. If there is a father in the Africa bush that has got a son, he's been living there, and he had a dream for his son, and you know, and his dream for his son is that his son would have a little mud hut like he has, and will have cattle like he has, and then his son would grow old, and that he would with him, and that he can share whatever he learned in life and his life with his son, and that he can have a friendship with that son, and that he can farm and you know, just go into the wild and pick some fruit from the trees and just see his grandkids grow up and all those kind of things and have a family. If that's a dream that the father had for the son, and all of a sudden a ship comes and comes to the shores of the African shores, and men with guns get off and kidnaps his son, or takes his son and goes and sell them in either the UK or wherever there was slavery in America, go and sell him, you know, in a market. And then this guy starts to work for the slave master. I mean, what would the father of the son describe as sin? He's definitely not going to describe sin in the lines of, if you've plucked enough cotton today, picked enough cotton. That is not going to be the definition of sin. The definition of sin will be, my son is not where I wanted him. That is sin. Sin means not to be a partaker of or not to have a share in. So if God has planned for man to have eternal life, to have peace and joy, to have a place with him in the Godhead where Jesus is seated as a man in the Trinity, if that is what God's plan was for man, anything less than that God sees as a sin. And forgiveness is defined in God setting you free from what's taking place. And when you go and look in the Old Testament, especially with Israel and how they were taken captive by the Egyptians, we find that you know, when God tries to explain to us the salvation plan, he defines people in bondage to slavery, to a slave master, as and setting them free. He defines that as forgiveness. That's what he defines as forgiveness. Forgive means to send away, to divorce, to let go, to set free. That's what the Greek word for forgive means. So, and that's without the shedding of blood, people couldn't go free. That's why a lamb was slain. And when the lamb was slain, the people could go out of the slavery into the desert, you know, and be set free from the oppression. So when we see the blood of Jesus, we cannot define the blood of Jesus as forgiveness for not making your 5 bricks or 10 bricks that you had to make under slavery, or bringing in enough cotton, or all those kind of things. We cannot define the blood of Jesus and that kind of forgiveness. It's got nothing to do with that. The blood of Jesus has got everything to do with setting people free from what enslaves them and destroys them and kills them. So we want the wrath of our Father. Because the wrath of our Father will destroy what destroys us. Glory to God. You know, you can find that you are in such, if you think of a slave on those cotton fields and being beaten and never good enough and all the torture he goes through, and he will be going through things that he's never been designed for. He will think thoughts that he would never have thought in the African bush. He would have desires to kill and murder and all those kind of things that he's never had in the African bush. And the worst thing of it all is if the Father would want to punish him now for having those thoughts on, you know, in the situation that he is in, saying, you know, my son, you know, it's just wrong for you to think that. And the slave master, I don't care what he's done, but now you've been wrong, and I'm a righteous father, and I'm a righteous, so, I mean, I'm siding with the slave master. That will destroy you, man. Now, we have not cognitively preached it that way, but that is what the subconscious mind concludes at the end of the day.
That's right.
And that's why we struggle to find faith in God. Mm-hmm. So when we look at the vengeance of our God, I want to read from Isaiah 61, and we're going to look at the vengeance of God and how God took vengeance out on what destroys his people. I tell people all the time, and I this is a warning even unto myself, I cannot preach a message that will make people slaves.
Amen.
For God has come to destroy anything that will keep his people in bondage. Mm. That's how you become the enemy of God, man.
Yeah.
By putting people in making them your slaves, making them your servants. Mm-hmm. Not have an internet ministry, web church, those kind of things, and make people my slaves. Mm-hmm. Bind them to me, you know, because when they're in that enslavement, God will come to me and he will whisper in my ear in the beginning, and he will say, Basti, let my people go. That's what he's going to say,
yeah.
You know. And if you've enslaved enough of them and that you've built a big enough kingdom by them, it might be difficult to let them go.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so... You know, for people that watch us via the web, if you're a church leader or something, I'm not pointing fingers at all, but don't even build something like that.
Mm.
Don't get there, you know. God is not very sentimental when it comes to Hagar and Ishmael. You know, he's not very sentimental. You know, he says, listen, let them go. You know, I've promised you, and I, by my promise, will bring things to you, not by your hard work or any of those things. Right, so let us go to Isaiah 61, and we're going to just look at this. This is beautiful. Jesus says, this is also quoted in Luke 4, and this is what it says. And Jesus came, and remember, he opened the book, and then he said, and then he started to read from this chapter. He said, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has enabled me to preach good tidings to the poor. Now listen to what Jesus says. He says, the fact that I can say good things to people means the Spirit of God is on me.
Mm.
Are you hearing what I'm saying?
Yes. Yeah.
If you come and you tell people about your burdens are lifted, you know, you are being set free, that's a sign that God's Spirit is on you. Because the word spirit, if we take the word spirit and we study that out in the Greek, now I don't say this is the only meaning, but I think it's a meaning that needs to be emphasized in the church and in our hearts. One of the meanings for spirit means a vital principle that comes alive or that gives life. Another way of saying that is an atmosphere. You know, we can be here and there can be an atmosphere of peace. And that we would say it's a spirit of peace. And you can look at somebody and you can say, he's got a real kind spirit. You know, you can say that guy, he's just like an angry spirit on him. You know? Or you can go to a house and say, there's just a spirit of turmoil there.
Mm-hmm.
So when we come and we are now feeling or entering the spirit or the atmosphere that is in the Godhead or in the Trinity, what is that spirit? Jesus said, the fact that I can come and speak good about people means the spirit of God is on me. Because he speaks good. Remember that the word Barak, which when God made man and the Bible says, and he blessed man. That word blessed, Barak, to stand on bended knee and speak well of. So that is it. That's the spirit of the Trinity. That's the spirit of God to speak well of, to set free, to bring life. Amen. So Jesus says, that spirit is upon me because I have been enabled to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and the opening of prison to those who are bound. So the Spirit of God is a spirit that will declare liberty, freedom, whatever. Now, listen to this. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach good tidings to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, proclaim liberty to the captives, the opening of the prison to those who are bound. So you get captives and those that are bound. So the Spirit of God is not good news for those who keep people captive. It's not good for the people who own the jail. That's not good news. That's bad news. Because this Spirit is going to come and declare freedom for these people. Okay. So, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord and the day of the vengeance of our God. To comfort all who mourn. Okay, now, so when we think of the vengeance of God, it says here, very clearly, it says, listen, the Spirit of God is upon me. He's come, he has anointed me to declare freedom for people. Opening of prison, release for people, and all those kind of things. He has enabled me. Now he's explaining what this is all about. He's enabled me to announce the Jubilee of God. Yes. That's what he's enabled me. He's enabled me to declare this is the acceptable year of the Lord. Explaining what this acceptable year is. The day of the vengeance of our God. For what purpose? To comfort all who mourn. Meaning that the vengeance of God will comfort. Well, that's not really bad news, is it? That's good news. Yes. Yep. That is good news. And we're going to look at some of the stuff tonight and just go in depth into this, explaining the good news of the vengeance of our God. Glory to God. Now it goes on, it says, to console those who mourn in Zion, to give to them beauty for ashes. So now listen, so what happens? You'll find somebody that is bound, and he will receive beauty for the ashes. Okay? That mourning that he was in, and all those kind of things, he'll receive beauty for that. And I'm sure there's a lot of deeper meanings into that, but just look at it's like, for whatever was not nice, you receive something that's nice. That's what he's trying to say here. Yeah. Okay. The garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. So in other words, if you had a spirit of heaviness, what will God bring unto you? A garment of praise. That they may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. So what he says is God will come and he will bring something forth in man that we cannot, that when we behold man, we will say this is a planting of the Lord, a tree of righteousness. Where under this slavery, it wasn't a tree of righteousness. Under this slavery, it was called a bad tree, a disobedient tree, cursed. But now God will come and in his vengeance, he will bring peace to those that are mourning. He will bring beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for those that are mourning, and make them trees of righteousness. And they shall rebuild the old ruins, they shall rise up the former desolations, and they shall repair the ruined cities, the desolation of many generations. I want to go to verse 7. It says, instead of shame, they shall have double honor. Instead of confusion, they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess double. Everlasting joy shall be theirs. Okay? Now we're talking about the day of the vengeance of our God. So it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me, enabled me. You know, the Spirit of God is upon me because, my goodness, I'm now going to announce good things. The Spirit of liberty, the Spirit of freedom is upon me. I'm going to set people free. They've been mourning. They've been going through hard times. They've been heartbroken. They've been in jail. They are not free. And I will come and I will give them double for all the trouble that they've been in. Double what? Double blessing. Amen? Yep. Now let's go to Psalm 40. And we're going to see how the build up to this. Psalm 40 verse 1. It says, so in other words, what will be the remember what we said there? It says, this is the day of the vengeance of our God to comfort all who mourn. Now it says, comfort. Yes, comfort my people, says your God. Speak comfortably to Jerusalem and cry out to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned. For she has received from the Lord double for all her sins. Now, what does that mean? If we define sin from the perspective of the Father, if we define sin as it is God's people were going through turmoil, being enslaved, being taken captive by the Pharaoh, to make it a spiritual Pharaoh, a system that could not produce fruit, could not produce God's dream for his people. So Adam went and he partook of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, trying to have life by that tree, and that tree could not produce fruit. That tree, God's issue was not that Adam would eat of that tree. God's issue was that tree cannot see that my dream would live in these people. That was his issue. Because that was his dream for his people. You know, it's like your kids. You don't want to say your kids are not allowed to have a good time. But you don't want your kids to have a good time to their own detriment. That's the very same thing. You can have the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, but if that tree cannot produce immortality and eternal life in you, and you partook of it, especially if you were deceived into it, and it's taken you captive, and God likens what's happening to his children with people that were taken captive by another nation, then he will come and he was going to move in and is going to come with his power, and he is going to set his people free. That's it. Amen. He's going to move in. He's going to say, it's not right that my children are bound by sin and destruction and all those kind of things. And I am going to set them free. Glory to God. The gospel that we've used to hear was, you better get free from your sin if you don't want God to kill you.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yes.
That's the kind of thing that was, let me put it this way, it would not be preached exactly like that, but if you go and ask somebody in the street what they think, what they're hearing, and what's the message taken together, that's the message. It's, here's a God, he's sin conscious, you better repent, then you need to try again, and if you don't get it right, you better repent again, and you just hope that he comes just after a repentance. Otherwise, you're not going to make it. Meantime, God is saying, it's a sin that my people need to live like that, and I'm going to give them double from my hand for all their sins that they've been going through. And here we see in chapter, just a few chapters on, chapter 61, verse 7, what this double is. What is the double they will receive from the Lord's hand? You have been in bondage, in slavery. You were not a partaker of the life that I had for you, that I've dreamt for you. And I'm coming in with a vengeance. And I'm taking vengeance on what's destroying my people. I'm taking vengeance of the power of sin in the flesh. And I am destroying that. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. So, when we look at this, I mean, when we thought of the day of the vengeance of God, we thought of You know, like, even Christians need to be careful. Because, you know, God's coming in with a vengeance. And he's going to destroy, and he's coming. That will be the day when he had enough. He had enough of disobedience. He had enough of people not wanting to listen to him and all those kind of things. And people have angered him and he's coming in. No, that is not what the day of the vengeance is. The day of the vengeance is, listen, the Spirit of God is upon me. And this is the day of the vengeance, the acceptable year of the Lord. Where these people were living in slavery, they never felt accepted. They never felt nice. There was no jubilee for them. There was no writing off of your debt. You're a slave forever. And now God comes and he's declaring, you can now go back to your original land. You can have your original ground back. All debt is canceled. That is what he's saying. He's saying your slavery has ended. This is the vengeance of our God. He's coming to end slavery. Coming in with a vengeance. And we can find, you know, these people in their slavery and whatever, and the devil and his kingdom and everything and the lies and whatever that was keeping people in fear and in bondage. Number one, they were ashamed of God. They were ashamed standing before God. Remember what I said this morning, what that ashamed is. If I've got an old beaten up car and another guy comes and we go into the same reunion, and this guy was with me in the same grade, and he stops there with his Lamborghini. And my car looks like a convertible, but because of the rust in the roof. Then all of a sudden you feel ashamed. Why? Because you're not on equal ground. But what God came to take that shame away by taking a man and putting a man in the Godhead. So that when we behold that man, we can see how that man relates to God. And how God relates to that man. And we see, if you've seen the one, you've seen the other one. And that man is our high priest. And he stands for us. And when we see that, our shame is away. We don't feel God's driving a bigger car than what we do. We find that God made a duplicate of his own car and put you in that car. So that you can come and stop at the same place with him. That shame cannot hinder the communication between you and him. That you will not do five things to find favor with him. But that there can be equal ground. Amen. So, what God has come to do, he's come with a vengeance to end all of these things. Now, let's go and look at some vengeance scriptures. So, when it talks about the day of the vengeance of our God, I've had some folk obviously say to me, no, Bertie, this just talks about a futuristic event. It's not now. You know, it's not in Jesus' time. Now, we're going to look at Scripture and what Scripture says about that and how people understood prophecy in the time of Jesus. And we're going to look at this vengeance. And we're going to see that the day of the vengeance of our God started when Jesus was upon the earth, when he ended the legalistic system whereby man had to try and find life to God. Wherein the Jews, what they were supposed to do, they were supposed to take the law and they should have been a light unto the Gentiles. But they weren't. They took it for themselves. Made themselves the special people and the others are the outcasts. And God came and said, that is an injustice that's been done to the Jews as well as to the Gentiles. And I'm going to end that my people can be free, for he loves his people. Right, let's go to Malachi. Malachi 4. And I remember even just after I got saved, I was thinking there's going to be a day of vengeance of our God. And God just had enough of people. That's not true. Man, it's wonderful to know God's for us, isn't it?
Yes.
He's for us. He's not against us. He's for us. Now we're going to go to Malachi 4, verse 1. Behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, and all the proud, yes, all that do wickedly will be stubble. And the day which is coming shall burn them up, says the Lord of hosts, that will leave them neither root nor branch. But to you who fear my name, the sun, S-U-N, like the day of righteousness, a sun is coming up, a day that's dawning, the sun of righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings. And you shall go out and grow fat like stall-fed calves. You shall trample the wicked, for they shall be ashes under your soles and under your feet in the day that I will do this, says the Lord of hosts. Remember the law of Moses, my servant, when I commanded him in Horeb in Israel with the statutes and the judgments. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. So there's a great and dreadful day of the Lord. And just before the great and dreadful day of the Lord, he's going to send somebody called Elijah, who will prepare the way of the Lord. Who is this Elijah? John the Baptist. So here's John the Baptist. John the Baptist is going to come just before this terrible day of the Lord. There's going to be a terrible day. Now, Malachi see in the vision when he wrote this down? He saw a sun, you know. He saw a heat and a fire. And he saw chaff burning. And then ashes. And then he saw people walking on these ashes. That's what he saw. And he wrote all that down. And then he said, Elijah, the prophet, would come. And then before this terrible day of the Lord, which will burn like an oven. Now, this day, imagine you, in South Africa, we've got days like that, you know, where you get up in the morning and at 6 in the morning, it is, before the sun comes up, it's already like 95. And then when that sun comes out, if it's at 6, 7, when the sun is on the horizon, you can feel the intense heat of that thing. Now, that's what he saw. And he likened that to the day of the Lord, the day of vengeance, where the sun, this fire of righteousness, will burn. Because our God says, it is not right that my people are going through that. And I'm bringing my righteousness. I'm bringing my righteousness. And I'm going to, in my righteousness, set people free. For it's not righteous, it's not good that people are bound by sin and destruction and all those kind of things. I want to set them free. So the Son of Righteousness will arise with healing in his wings. Okay? So what will the Son of Righteousness, this terrible day of the Lord, do? He will bring healing to those who fear his name. But to those who have no respect for the word salvation, that's got no respect for God will help you, that's got no respect for freedom, that will be terrible. To the jail keepers, it will be a terrible day. That's going to burn them up. So here he comes and he says, you know, that there will be healing in the wings. Now, you remember the lady that had the issue of blood. She came and the Bible says that she just wanted to touch the hem of his garment. Now the hem of the garment was, they had this pressure, and at the bottom of that they were instructed to make these tassels with blue in them. And those were called, and if you can study that out in the Old Testament, those were called the wings.
Yeah.
Okay? Those were called the wings of the garment. And that's the very thing that she wanted to touch. Why would you think that a lady with an issue of blood will hide between people, go through the fear of being stoned and killed, because she had an issue of blood, she had to stay outside of town according to the law. She was an outcast. She cannot come into town. And she had it for many years, this issue. That she would come in and then all of a sudden go in between the people and just touch the hem of the garment. What would make her do that? And why would you find in Matthew 13 onwards, it says there that many went and touched the hem of the garment. And they were all healed. Why? Because those people took Malachi 4, which says, the Son of Righteousness, the day of the vengeance of our God, now is the judgment, they said. That's what they thought. And then they saw Jesus walking and they said, this is the terrible day of the Lord. This is the Son of Righteousness and there's healing in His wings. And He has come to bring justice and righteousness to the oppressed and to the sinner. And we know this is the fulfillment of that prophecy. So let us touch the hem of that garment. And they were made healed.
Wow.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
That's what happened there. The fire of God was burning. And if you go and look at even Matthew 3, verse 14, here John the Baptist is. And he is baptizing. And he's just in front of the terrible day of the Lord. And here the Pharisees come, you know, and he's very sarcastic to them. They come to spy out what he's doing. They don't come to be baptized by him. The people that were baptized by him thought that they were sinners. The day of the Lord is coming. Some of them were afraid even. You know, they didn't understand these things probably in a good way. And they went to John the Baptist and they said, let me be baptized by John in the awaiting. We know the Messiah is coming and we want to repent, for we want the Messiah, you know, the coming of the Messiah. So they were still in a bit of a legalistic understanding of this day. And here John comes and the Pharisees come and they walk down there to just spy out what he's doing. Because John was doing the unthinkable. He was baptizing the Jew boys. John was doing the unthinkable. He was baptizing Jews. Now, in that time, if you go and study it out, the Pharisees, and then there was different Jewish, if you're going to call it sects. And what they did was they made disciples, and as they were making these disciples, what they would do, there was a certain ritual. Now, I don't know everything about the rituals, but one of the things they did was they were teaching, and they made disciples, and by making a disciple, they baptized them in their name. Mm-hmm. Meaning they becoming disciples of this guy. That was a tradition. And they went to the Gentiles and to the Greeks, and they took some Greek people and converted them to Judaism. That's what they did. And then they would baptize these, and the baptism would be a baptism of repentance or a sinner's baptism. But here John comes, and he does the unthinkable, and he baptizes Jews. By baptizing a Jew, what the Jew would hear is, John is saying that these Jews aren't children of God. They can become children of God. That's why they went to spy out, what in the heck is going on here? And then John's very sarcastic and he says, who have warned you against the coming wrath? As if they are now coming to be baptized. I mean, that was just like an insult, you know? And then he gets to the point and he said to them, listen guys, let me tell you the truth. God can out of these stones make sons of Abraham. Don't have any confidence in the fact that Abraham is your father. It's going to mean nothing to you. And by just doing that, he burnt up the whole Hebrew system. Why? Because there's somebody standing on the shores or the banks of that river, ready to enter into that river. To take the sin of the whole world upon him. Mm-hmm. To go out of that river as the scapegoat and walk into the desert, signifying the carrying away of sins.
Well, I appreciate it.
Amen. So he says, listen to what Malachi 3 says. You don't want to find the right place here. It says here, behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. So in other words, there will be a messenger that will go before the Lord. And this messenger will prepare the way. And then, so how did he prepare the way? This is the preparing of the way. Let me tell you the way of Jesus. Jesus' way is I am ending the system where your confidence can be in Abraham as your father. Mm-hmm. Ending the whole law-based system by which people were righteous in their flesh. Mm-hmm. I'm righteous because I'm a Jew or a child of Abraham. He says, I'm come to end that. Okay? He says, then he goes on, he says, and the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant in whom you delight. Behold, he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming? And who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like a launderer's soap. He will sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver. Silver speaks of redemption. He says, I will refine redemption. I will clean out this redemption thing, because this law system and all of it and the prophets and all those kind of things, these people didn't preach the message right. So I'm ending that whole thing and I am bringing perfect redemption. He says, I will purify the sons of Levi, meaning I'm cleaning the priesthood. Then he goes on, and I will purge them as gold and silver. He will bring the perfect priest, which is Christ. Then that they may offer to the Lord an offering in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasant to the Lord. I want to just get where it says he will leave them neither root nor branch. I don't know. Oh, here it is in chapter 4, chapter 4, verse 1. So we see in chapter 3 here, clearly it comes and he says, there's come a day, and who will be able to stand in his day? Who will stand before God when Jesus comes? Nobody can say, my way has been the correct way. So he's ending all the ways that people thought was unto God. He ends all of that and he brings the truth. And chapter 4 says here, he says that he will burn all the chaff and it will leave them neither root nor branch. What does that mean? That means that when the Jews stood, those Pharisees stood and they were, we are the children of Abraham. You know, and we've got the law, and we are righteous because I'm of the tribe of Judah, I'm of the tribe of Benjamin, I'm of the tribe of this one, that one, whatever. They were standing there from looking from their high horse, you know, with their righteousness by the works, and the Gentiles were just sinners and bad, and their confidence were in the flesh. I'm a son of Abraham and I am even circumcised. And here he comes and he says to them, he even removes the root. He leaves them neither root nor branch. He removes the root. What was the root in them? Father Abraham. And he says, God can even of these stones raise up children unto Abraham. Repent of your sins. So what did he do? He came and he removed any fleshly system. And he says that you need to realize that you are in need of a Savior. That's what you need to know. And by that, any system that could declare a man righteous was burnt up. And the only thing that can declare righteousness is Christ being a friend of sinners. That's the only way. There was no other way. Hallelujah. So we look at this fire of God that is burning. We look at this, the judgment of God that comes to man. We've thought that the fire, we even see the disciples of Jesus not even understanding this thing correctly. They walk through Samaria, and then all of us, Jesus asked permission to go through a town.
Yeah.
And then they said, we just asked permission. They says, no, we don't want you to walk through this town. We're not accepting Jesus here. Then the disciples said, well, you know, if they don't want to accept you, you know, we know Elijah and the spirit of Elijah. So shall we, like Elijah, call fire from heaven and consume these people? They weren't understanding those scriptures, man. Listen to what Jesus says. You don't know of what spirit you are. In other words, what he's saying is, you don't know what's going on in the Godhead. You don't know God's attitude towards these people. Now you want to destroy their lives. The Son of Man has not come to destroy men's lives, but he's come to save men's lives. So the fire falling from heaven, if you want to call fire from heaven, it must be the fire that saves people's lives. not destroy their lives. And they thought, this is a righteous thing. God is angry and God want to burn away. God is not there to burn away people. He's there to burn away what destroys people.
Amen.
Yeah. Yes.
Anything that we think we can do to be saved by our works burns away. It is slavery. What does the Bible say? The power of sin is the?
Law.
Is the law.
Mm-hmm.
1 Corinthians 15. The power of sin is the law. Then it goes on. And it says the ministration of death was written on stones. Then it goes on in Romans 7, and it says very clearly there, it says that we, he says, I speak to those that know the law. And then he uses this marital thing. He says, if you were married to Moses or married to the law, through the law, you will bear fruit unto death. And that which you want to do, you will not do it. And that which you don't want to do, that you will do. And that is what God was frustrated with, if you want to see frustration in the heart of God. He was saying, it is not right that my people are bound to a system that cannot produce love, peace, joy, kindness, meekness, temperance, and all those things in them. For I have designed them to live by that. I've given them all the receptors and the ability to live that kind of a life. They're the perfect vessel wherein all love can dwell. But they are part of a system, a satanic system, that cannot bring that forth. People didn't read the law the way they were supposed to read the law. The way you're supposed to read the law is to see Jesus. For Jesus said, you study the scriptures and you seek life in the scriptures, but those things cannot bring you life. They talk about me, and I'm the one that can bring you life. And by saying that, he burned it all up. The day of the vengeance of our God, wherein it was said that if you are sick, you're cursed by God. That's what it was said. And then Jesus came to the sick, which was the so-called cursed by God. And he says, he didn't say, you can be healed. He says, son, you know, your sins are forgiven you. What is the sins? You know, the sins, the Jewish thing was, the sins are something you do wrong, therefore you're under some kind of a curse. To God, it's a sin that you are paralyzed, man. It's a sin that you are dying. You are not a partaker of the life I've intended for you. And he came and he says, you think you're poor? I will tell you, you are rich. You think that through this sickness, it's a sign that I'm not for you? I want to tell you, you are already healed, man. Mm-hmm. I see you as the healed. I see you as the rich. I see you as mine. Why rich? Because the Jewish system for wealth was such an important thing. Because they, if you go and read Deuteronomy 28, all the blessings of Deuteronomy 28, most of them was about money and health. So the richer you are, the more of a child of God you are. That's why it said even, look at this, how Jesus burns up this whole system. A rich man comes to Jesus and say to him, a rich ruler, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life, or that I may have eternal life? So what those Jews were seeking was eternal life. That's what they were seeking. Jesus, and what must I do? And Jesus, it boiled down to that Jesus said, listen, find no confidence in your money. Give it to the poor. In other words, if you can come to the place where you can see the poor is rich, that's what must take place in your mind. And then you come and follow me, and they'll have a treasure in heaven. Then they asked Jesus. And then Jesus said, it's difficult for a rich man to be saved. Then they said, now, if a rich man cannot be saved, who then can be saved? Because they believed that if you were rich, the blessing of God was already upon you. And that system of laws unto blessing, meaning the stamp of God's approval. What did Jesus say? He said, you know, with God all things are possible, not with man. And what does he do? The fire of righteousness comes and burn away that which keeps man in toil. And had the poor had this torture in their heart. This pain inside their heart. because I'm not accepted. I can't make it. I'm not good enough. I'm just a dog. I'm just a dog. I'm just a nothing. And Jesus comes, and what does he do? The Son of God comes and he shows the Word of God. And the Word of God is, I love the sinner. I'm amongst the sinner. I'm for the sinner. And he burns up. And you know what Jesus said? He said, I wish to kindle this fire. And he set it ablaze when he was upon the earth. Now I want to tell you that fire is still burning today.
Amen.
Yes.
It's still burning today.
Yes.
And will continue to burn until that fire consumes all death.
Mm-hmm.
Until the immortality promised by Jesus, by the Father in the beginning, shines in man. And the last enemy it will destroy is the physical death of man.
Yeah.
That fire of God's love. For he says, it's not right that my people suffer. I've had enough of the suffering of my people, and I'm bringing forth righteousness. The Son of Righteousness, the judgment of God. You know, if the Father comes from the Africa bush and he comes with judgment, he's not judging his son.
No.
No. He's judging what keeps his son enslaved.
Yes.
That's what he's judging, and that's what Christ has come to do. And the greatest fire that burnt was the following. Unless you holy and righteous and everything goes well with you, you know, you cannot be a partaker of the kingdom of God. Here Jesus comes and says, let me show you what God's word is. And I spoke about it this morning and last night. He said, I will take a man without any sin. And then he will be like a sponge. And then he will absorb all the sin of all people on him. Then when he's got all sin on him, I'll promise him eternal life. Okay? Then he became the man hanging on the tree, the cursed. And he said to man, look at yourself hanging here, the cursed. I am dying here. I've got all sin. I've got death upon me. I'm the cursed. That is cursed as everyone that hangs upon a tree. And I want to tell you the voice of the Father. The Father has promised me that He'll raise me on the third day. Without sin. Immortal. Perfectly blessed. Inheriting the immortality that only belongs to God. And He died. And he rose again and burnt up this whole system that God cannot love sinners. That the promise of God is not for all. All of a sudden we see the promise is for all. And we see the immortality in Christ as a word for all. So that those who can believe this will be saved from the lie and the torture they are living in. That's what will take place. Our God is a... What does the Bible say? Our God is a consuming fire.
Yep.
Hallelujah. Mm. Glory to God. And you know what the Bible talks about? It talks about an unquenchable fire. You can come with the helicopters and with the biggest fire hose. You can think you've ended this fire. And then it starts again.
Yeah.
You cannot quench it until all is consumed. You know what the Bible says? He will baptize us with the Holy Spirit
and fire.
That's why to the one we come in and we say the beautiful Spirit of God. We come baptized in the Holy Spirit, declaring the good news. And as we declare the good news, it's a fire. We baptized with the Holy Spirit and fire. It's the same thing. It's the very same thing. If you can either experience it as something that consumes you or make you happy, depending on which side of the line you stand.
Yeah.
Like Wayne said about the hardening of the heart. There are some folk that when they see the righteous bless the poor, Psalm 112 says, then they gnash with their teeth. I want to tell you, with this fire burning, there's going to be a lot of gnashing of teeth. Because God's going to show His goodness and His love towards people we thought never deserved it. We're going to see how He burns up legalism, how He burns up bondage, that His people can be free. Not free. Freedom is not defined in do whatever you want. Freedom is defined in you are free to have the life of God.
Yes.
Yep.
You're already free to go and do whatever you want. That you're already free. But that is not freedom. We need to be free to have love in our heart.
Yes.
I mean, I want to be free in this sense. And this is how I believe Paul defines freedom. Is he said, under the law, I'm not free to love. I can't get it right. I can try, but I found that I can't get it right. I'm the law. It's all about me, myself, and I. And I just look at who I am in the flesh, and I sneer on others that are not like that. And Paul says, you know, the commandment that says you shall not desire, the more I try to do that, the more concupiscence, in the Greek, wild forms of lust, came up in my heart. And then he only came to the conclusion, wretched man that I am. I can see a commandment that shows a life that I can never attain. Mm-hmm. It's like a carrot in front of a horse or a donkey. You can never get to the thing. I want the freedom to look at somebody and have compassion, man.
Yes.
You know, you look at Jesus, he comes to the earth and he walks here and in his heart he feels love for people.
Yes.
He loves them. He weeps, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, I wanted to gather you like a hen gather her chicks. Where? Under the wings. Okay? I wanted to heal you with a healing in the wings that I talked about. You remember touching the hem of the garment, the healing of the wings? This is the day of the judgment of our Lord with healing in the wings, healing in the pressure, touching the edge of that, those tassels, healing in the wings. I wanted to gather you under my wings, but you didn't want to. And there's a cry in his heart. We said, Jesus, you know, say to Zacchaeus, today I must come to your house. It's talking about an urge in his heart, a compassion inside him, where the very core, the Brennan Manning says, where in the womb of Yahweh is moved to be good to his people. We look at Jesus having that, and he's living from the heart of God, good towards people, but here we stand, and we must open the Bible and look at a commandment and say, well, the Lord says you must love somebody. Okay, Lord, now I'm going to love. That's not fair, man. That's not right. I don't want that life. I'm not interested in that life. I'm not interested in the life of obedience. I'm interested in being born of God.
Amen.
That's what I'm interested in. I want to be born of God. And whatever obedience it would take to have that birth, I'm willing. And the only obedience is, let me do it. Yes, Lord, I'm willing. And He'll bring it forth in you. That's why He says, I take vengeance on anything that will not be the genuine thing in my people. We have been made and designed to be the children of God, to be born of God, to have a life, not just physical descent or something like that. Born, having my thoughts, my compassions, sharing in the very heart of God, co-feeling, co-thinking with God. That's what He's come to set us free unto. And His vengeance is against anything that will not allow that. And He showed it in Christ. And I can stand today, and it doesn't. And I find that all the wickedness that was done towards me, the system, the wickedness that was done towards man, enslaving man, after I see Jesus upon the cross, and I see a promise made to a man carrying all the sin of all the world, carrying my sin, and that his sin was not, the sin he carried was not stronger than the promise of our Abba, and the Father could raise him, I want to tell you that old system is ashes under my feet, man. I don't care for that system anymore. I walk on it. It's burnt. It's gone.
Amen.
It's burnt to ashes. We've got a system where we can have freedom and life. Glory to God. Where we can say, we are rich.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
We are healed. We've been chasing so much after the physical healing that we could never understand that Jesus came to heal our belief. He came to heal what we believe, man. That's the biggest thing. You know, you can still go to a doctor and he can kind of heal your body. But nobody is going to heal your belief. You need some truth. And that truth was manifested. The truth about what God planned for us, the truth about who we are, everything. Imagine the slave in this, under this torture of slavery. All of a sudden, he sees a vision. If you want to call it a vision, or like we would call an open vision. You see, he sees into the heavens, and he sees that he is sitting with his father. Wouldn't that burn up all slavery in his mind?
Yes.
The day of the vengeance of our God. It has been burning from then, and it is still burning. And Jesus Christ will come back, and we will see the last enemy, even death in the human body, healed. And people might say, but that's not possible. You know, there are many theological debates about that, but there's one argument I stand on, and it's this. Show me Jesus' bones.
Yeah.
If you can show me those bones, then I'll give your doctrine a minute. But if you cannot show me those bones, then I am going to be in the likeness of his resurrection. Then I tell you, the bones that's not there is a fire against what you believe.
That's right.
It's burning it up. And all I can say is I can just look. It's not me. It's just the truth. So church, God loves us. And he's against what is against us, not against us. If our lives are born from that which is against God's people, we'll experience pain. And you guys know my ministry. You know, I wrote that book on Jesus is the tithe. I've preached on that tithing thing. You know, it doesn't help how many times people resist it. It's going to cover, that truth will cover the planet. It's just a matter of time. It will continue to spread. I don't have to be against anybody. I don't have to be angry at anybody. Jesus didn't come angry at the Pharisees. He was even angry at the things that kept the Pharisees in bondage. He loved them as well. He's not against people. He's against a wrong belief that finds its origin in Satan. He knows who the enemy is. Glory to God. Amen. Man, I think I've preached long enough. This is good news, isn't it?
Yes.
It's good news. The cross has burnt away this whole thing of God cannot be good to sinners. We saw the promise made to sinners. Hallelujah. We see it fulfilled. And we know that it was not just to sinners, it was my sin, for Jesus didn't have his own sin. We see the scapegoat. Let me end off with this. Look at how Jesus wants to convince our hearts. He takes Old Testament types and shadows, okay? And he comes, and he knows we will understand these things. We will look at these things. It will convince our hearts. He comes and he says, right, if I'm baptized with the baptism of John, there are many prophetic things that will be fulfilled there, of which one is, I'm baptized with the baptism of the sinner. That was what John's baptism was. You went confessing your sin. Did Jesus have sin? No. That's why John said he could baptize Jews because he knew they were sinners. But he couldn't baptize Jesus. He says, no, I cannot baptize you, Jesus. Jesus says, baptize me that we might fulfill all righteousness. Because righteousness, God's equitable deed, can be fulfilled by me doing this. Because God's equitable deed is in setting free his people. Amen. And then when I get baptized into this river, I, by faith, know I stand up here in the same baptism that you baptized with, the baptism of repentance, and I fully identify with the sin of mankind. Mm-hmm. And when the Son of God believes that, you know what it is then? Then it is so.
Right.
And then from there, he walked into the desert The Bible says the Holy Spirit led him by into the desert. If you go and read Leviticus 16, it clearly says that a ready man stood there. A man of good character would stand there, and when the scapegoat received the sins upon him, he would take the goat and quickly lead him into the desert. And here we see Jesus walking into the desert, all types and shadows, convincing the heart of man that God says, listen, I want to show you what promise I can make to a man that is in the deepest darkness. And Jesus walked and he did miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle, proving something about the people that were sick's true condition. I love that piece where he said to the man that was the paralytic, he says, son, your sins are forgiven you. Then they said to him, that's nonsense, man. Number one, you know, you can see these Jews thinking, he is sick. How can you say he's without sin? A man born blind, Jesus healed him. After he was healed, then they come to Jesus, to the blind man comes and preaches to these learned people. And then he said, they said, man, you were born in your sin because you were born blind. So sickness equals sin in those Jewish minds. And here Jesus comes and he says, you are healed. You are healed. Son, that word when he says, son, your sins are forgiven you. Go and study it in the Greek. It means mankind.
Yep.
The son of man. Talks about man. Not just a son.
That's right.
Talks about man. Man, your sins are forgiven you. And miracle after miracle after miracle. Then they came to him and said to him, listen. By what authority, what gives you the power to do all these miracles? Jesus said to them, the baptism of John. Mm-hmm. Is it of God or is it of man?
Yeah.
So what he's saying is, what gives me the authority to set these people free is because they are the people of God, man. Mm-hmm. Their sins is not on them. I see them in a different way. And then he went to the cross, showed all the sin, came to a place where he says, now I'll take the wages of sin upon me, which is death and being cursed and beaten and all those kind of things, to the point that we can look at him and say, cursed is he, beaten, smitten of God. He wasn't beaten and smitten of God. The Bible says we esteemed him beaten and smitten of God. Was not beaten of God. We esteemed him beaten, smitten of God. Think of this picture. Last year I used this picture. If you take the picture of the Roman soldier beating Jesus, okay? And you see that, you know, that whip with those nails and things in him, grabbing him. Think of the passion of the Christ. And see that picture. Who's God in that picture? Jesus or the Roman soldier? If you say, God beat Jesus, then God must be in the Roman soldier. But the Bible doesn't say that. God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. And here he was willing to come and show the utmost curse. And he went, and in that cursed state, he had a promise. The Father will raise me. And none of the sin of the world is stronger. Neither sin, death, nothing can separate me from the promise I have in my Father. And all he did was he relied upon the love of the Father, and the Father raised him up without sin, without death, which is the promise unto all of us. Look how he convinces our hearts to bring a message of faith that we can believe in Jesus and so be saved from the turmoil we live in. Amen. Father, I want to thank you for your grace and your mercy. I want to thank you for the vengeance of our God. I want to thank you that you've come and you've poured out your vengeance, and that you are continuing to pour it out, and that it will burn up all everything that does wickedly. And we see where it started. It's burning out all the branches. It's burning out the roots. It's burning out everything. And we are seeing how you took two people groups, Jew and Gentile, and you took the enmity, which was the law with its commandments, and you ended it in the cross, saying all people have sin, but the promise is to all.
Amen.
And thank you, Father, that your promise raises us up without sin, raises us up with a hope of immortality. Father, I want to thank you that Romans 6 is so true, where it says that shall we continue to sin? God forbids it. It's not us forbidding sin anymore. We find that your nature, your being, forbids it. And all we can do is we can stand in awe of our Abba, and the wonderful thing is done for us. My Father, I want to thank you that I can pray for the people that are here. I thank you that as we are sitting here, we can gather around the awesome truth of your love for us. And I thank you that the people that are here that has been set free will just continue in this freedom and have it reinforced in their hearts. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You're such a good God. And thank you, you've come to baptize with the Holy Spirit and fire. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much. Amen. Hallelujah. Isn't God good?
Amen.
He is only good. Can we clap our hands for Jesus? Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, thank you so much, Terry. You've got, well, my books, I'm sorry, the books are gone. So if you want books, Jesus the Tithe, go online. You can order them there. There is a price on the, you know, the